L, so Mr. Fischer.
Lars.
Lars?
Yeah.
Thank you very much, from Denmark.
Yeah.
Yeah, come on up.
Hello.
Hello. Our clicker isn't working too well, if you haven't noticed, so just use that mouse to
okay.
Hear your slides.
Sorry.
Hello everybody. So my name is Lars Fischer. I'm a beekeeper from the small but very nice country of Denmark. Together with my best friend and beekeeping buddy, Sufus. He's the bald, handsome guy down there. In 2017, we won the Carl and Virginia Silver Trophy for best honey in the world at the Apimondia in Istanbul. That was a really, really big experience, and I still get goosebumps all over when I think of it. We won the prize with a Danish creamed, I think it's called, spring honey. It's from our bee yard on the countryside. We had a lot of rape and dandelion nearby, and our spring honey is a really nice, spreadable, firm honey with a silky smooth texture and a mild taste. We actually prepared some samples. We took 60 glasses along because we thought, oh, there was maybe 30 people here. That's more than enough. Yeah. So if you're really, really interested in tasting our honey, we'll be outside for half an hour. You can come out and you can taste it. But I think it would be chaos if I try to give out 60 glasses here. Normally we have between 15-17% of water and rather much glucose, so we get a honey that crystallizes quickly. So we've learned a lot in the process, and we would like to share our experience because we think that our firm creamed honey is a product that could be used much more around the world, not just in Denmark, but also many other places. So just a quick overview about the process of crystallization. So the two important sugars in our honey for this topic, that's the glucose and the fructose. And the glucose, that's the sugar that wants to crystallize. And the more glucose we have, the harder the honey gets and the quicker it goes. The fructose is much more lazy. It just wants to hang around and be in the liquid phase still. Almost all Danish honey is a super saturated glucose solution, and that means it will start to crystallize at some point. And this process of crystallization will continue until the level of glucose is below the saturation point, and then it'll stop. And actually most honey worldwide is a super saturated solution of glucose. If there's enough glucose in the honey, at some point the crystals will start to stick together and form a three-dimensional grid. That sort of, it binds the whole honey together. So even in the hardest honey, there's Eva Crane states, it's only about 15% that's actually solid. The rest is still a fluid phase, caught in the cavities in this crystal grid. So the grid of crystals, it stabilizes the honey and prolongs the shelf life. So for us, it's important to get a good grid. Yeah, also a good grid. And you can see it if you have a firm honey. If it has a matte surface, it has a grid in there. So this process of crystallization, that can be sort of influenced by us, and we have some things that we can do to sort of make it the product that we desire. The important factors, that's the amount of glucose, it's the amount of water, but more importantly it's the temperature and the amount of nuclei in the honey, and especially the temperature and the amount of nuclei, that's really two factors that we can influence as beekeepers. What we've really learned is temperature, it's so, so important for the final properties of a product. If you want to make a hard honey, firm honey, or creamed honey, then keep it cold. The colder you can have it, the better. below 19 degrees. That's very, very important. Above 19 degrees, it will not be as smooth as we wanted. 14 degrees is much better than 19, and 5 is also really good. And I'm talking Celsius here, I'm European. So below 19 degrees
you're
Celsius.
You're in Canada, you're okay.
Okay, yeah. It depends on what you have. We have a cellar, so immediately when we have extracted our honey, take it down the cellar, we cool it, and it stays cool during the whole process. And then we often do that we seed our honey. We add a lot of nuclei so that the crystals will have a large number of crystals, and they will be smaller than if we didn't seed it, because the nuclei is also very important for this process. So this is obviously honey, it hasn't been seeded, it's not even granulated. We have just put it in the jar. It's just an example to see what can serve as nuclei. So between each layer of honey, when we jar it, there are micro air bubbles caught, and these air bubbles in this glass, and also in this one, has acted as nuclei where the crystal growth has started. So air bubbles, that's our nuclei. Pollen grains is also a nuclei, and other crystals can also be a good seed for the crystal growth. And that's what we do or use when we seed our honey. I'm pretty nervous, so when I'm nervous, I always forget to look in my papers. So I just, yeah, good. Yeah. Oh. Normally I talk about this for 2 hours, so it's a big challenge to sort of put it down for 12 minutes.
Put your papers away, please.
Yeah, exactly. So when we see the honey, and we won't go into details with the recipe, we'll be outside for the next hour or so. If you're curious, come out and we'll talk about it. We use ripe honey from our spring. It's a neutral honey, and that's good because we don't want it to taste in the new honey. And then it's also very, very important to cool both the seed honey and the raw honey down before you start mixing it. Cool is good. We start our seeding. We whip. This honey was very hard when we started, and then we whip it. And then it comes like this. So it's over whipped. There was a grit in the beginning, but the grit is gone now, and we just have a big pile of billions of tiny, tiny glucose crystals. And that is exactly what they want. They can start as seeds for the new crystals to grow on. Oh. And then we mix the honey. So I won't go into details with the recipe. There are many different ways of seeding. But what is important is that if you experiment with this, if you want to try it, write down how you did it. Because it'll be 1 year the next time, and then you have remembered. You have remembered what worked, and you have remembered, oh, it didn't work. Write it down, and then you can see, oh, last year it became a bit rough and rocky in the mouth. Then you can do something else. Change the time between each step in the seeding process, change the temperature, something. I can say in general, what's the time? How much time?
You got 5 minutes, Yola.
I have 5 minutes. Oh. If you want to make granulated honey, mechanical processing, that's really good for the crystallization process. Even the physical stirring of a honey promotes and starts crystal growth. Optimal water content is 17%. Keep it cold. Very important in the bucket. It's very important to keep the bucket cold, but also after you put it on jars. Store them cold, especially in the first time when the crystals still form in the glass. And then, of course, nuclei, lots of nuclei. We want those. It gives this smooth, silky texture that we like. Sometimes with our Danish spring honey, it becomes very, very hard after the crystal growth has stopped. You have to sort of chop the honey out. You can ripen a jar like that and make it spreadable again. And we do it by putting it around 24 degrees for a week or two. Then it softens up, and then you can put it down in your storage again, and it will stay smooth and spreadable. You can also do it quicker in 24 hours. Normally we don't heat our honey, but sometimes we make it a little bit hotter, and we think it's okay because that is also the temperature that the bees keep in their hive. And this also decreases the affinity for frosting, you know, where you see the glucose, the white glucose crystals on the side of your jars. I don't know, is it only in Denmark frosting is a problem?
No.
Okay, yeah. Well, it's not a problem because it's just a sign this is a good, dry, quality honey. But sometimes it confuses the customers. And if you want to participate in the contest here, you have to learn to avoid frosting, because I know judges, they don't like frosting. So you can decrease the risk of frosting by putting the honey jars warm for a period and then putting them down on the storage again. And about frosting, we did that actually with, this was a before glass, and this is the same glass afterwards. So the frosting has almost gone away. I can see it sort of a little bit, and it doesn't come back. And when I talk about frosting, the most important thing is never to jar your honey at room temperature, for example, and then put it cold afterwards. Because when you take something, you take it from the warmth and put it in the cold, the water contracts, and this affinity for frosting, where you sort of get a little layer without water, a little dry layer, that will become more
visible.
Yeah, thank you, Sophus. So, yeah, so I think I'm actually ready for a lot of questions.
Okay, we got a couple minutes. Please remind me to come up and use the mic so everyone can hear the question.
So just that last comment that you made about not putting it into a colder environment, and yeah. I understood that putting it in a freezer was a good way to actually cream honey.
Not to cream.
I've heard that it is creams too. It will cream. You know?
Well,
I'm only a second year beekeeper, so I don't know.
Yeah, my experience is that if I take a honey, I had a slide before with four glasses of honey. And I actually forgot to explain that picture. Could we find that slide again?
I asked last time and couldn't bring it up, so it's probably going to...
Okay, so these four glasses, which we hopefully will be showing, that is the, that is the same honey. Yes, this is the same honey. And we put it in different temperatures. So the one on your left, that has been crystallized in the jar in 26 degrees, and the one on the right with a little bit of frosting, that is 5 degrees. What is interesting is that the honey that was at 5 degrees was much, much smoother. The 26 degrees was coarse in its texture, and the 5 degrees was smooth. But the colder it is, the more frosting we get. I don't know how it will be in a freezer. Normally, people put honey in the freezer to avoid crystallization at all. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. I only tried it with 5 degrees. But 5 degrees is a good temperature because it'll get smoother, the crystals will get smaller. Oh, yes.
Yeah. Hey, round of applause. I think you could market frosting. I like that term on the honey.
Yeah, use it as a quality.
Yeah. Okay, our next speaker, Luis again. Is that close enough? Thank you. And he's going to be presenting on.